I was interested about Poland. The morning presentations were so fascinating to me. And after that, I'm glad I included that slide. And again, all of the political divisions of Poland today, and where are we? Right there. Now we're going to travel, and you can see how green it is. So we have little roads through the wonderful trees and forests, and there's some farmland and so forth, but we're up here, and our first stop, when we're going, this is Grobelpershing down here, now called Sverzno, and then the town it was attached to when my dad left, which was Rommelsburg, which is Miasto down there. I'm ruining all these words and the town names, I'm sure. Just as, this isn't very large, there's right up from here, this is a blow-up of this, is a festival that happens up in that town. They bike up there, they walk up there, it's not very far. So all of this can be done quite easily. The Koslin Archive, which we've all seen often, and we went there because at one time the Grobelpershing and the Placid Church were part of the Pritzig Lutheran Church. And the book for Pritzig, Kirschbuch, had just become available. So we were hoping for the best, and Ingrid made an appointment, got a table, did all the things you're supposed to do, and we arrived there promptly on time. We were disappointed that about 30 pages, as this other lady has said, were missing from 1835 to 1863, which was the time frame that we were looking for. But we did find a few entries. We did have a to-do list for some other people, and we were able to find some entries that helped other people. Now we're driving down to Grobelpershing, and from there to Rommelsburg is about 7.5 miles. So we're coming from here to here, which isn't very far, but for those of you who have driven in Poland, you know how far it is. And I don't mean to be sarcastic, it's just the driving in Poland, and when you're sitting in the back seat and somebody else is manning the maps, and it was an interesting experience, but they handled it. They had been there many, many times. They go about every 3-4 years and will research at Koslin and other archives, so they knew where they were going. All these little towns are related to people that were in Grobelpershing. And Kassig had the train station, and that's important. And actually, it still does have the train station. And it's the rail connection between Rommelsburg and going all the way up to Stolp, all the way up north, the whole line connection. So that's very important. That makes the town very important. At one point, Grobelpershing was the religious and civil registry for 28 towns. These towns in red are connected to my family. I don't have pictures of all of them, but and there are more towns too, but of the 28 towns, and wait till you see the church, it's not very big. These people, this is my dad, and what turned into his brother-in-law, Emil, that's the same man, and him, and my dad's brother, and Paul Berzloff, who is Helmer's uncle, and this is Emil. This man also came, but he returned. He had brought his mother, and he returned, and he did not get back in time before the war broke out. So they all went to Faribault, they all joined the same church, and they wound up marrying sisters, et cetera, et cetera. So they all wound up related to each other in some fashion. This is Grobelpershing, and this is looking at it, looking west. And that's important because most of the town is down there, and the library and the other homes, basically the rest of the town are over there, right? This is how you say it today. And there actually are two Sverznos in Poland, and you have to be careful when you're pulling them up on the internet. The other one is more by Kamin, more west. But there was only one Grobelpershing. The other one actually is a bigger town, and has, you can find it more easily because it has more business and has more industry and so forth. And you can see that the population for Grove's version in 1905 and what it is today. The noble families for the area, this is where Grove's version was, and the Leto and the Masao families, and Masao's finally got it, I'm sure I'm not saying that right, when Leibachutum, this is 1500, so when Leibachutum, this is a map that would apply during that time, this is from Paul's work, book, the Christ Rummelsburg. We know that there was nobility because this is a noble house and a good house. And so, right, I've never heard my parents talk about the nobility of Grove's version. But we know that there was one. And we also know Hans Borchert, who I met in Falling Hostel, and his family, who was the next slide, they escaped from Grove's version. He drew this of the town. And there's a boot. So there was a house. There's my grandpa, and there he is again. And Karen, there's the Glinkies. And Krugel is also a surname that's in our genealogy. And there's the Vilwalks, Mrs. Vilwalk that we saw with back in Falling Bostel. This is Hans Borchert, and I have his book. He very kindly gifted me that. And has written other books. So on your website sheet, there is his website, and he's written some follow-up books as well. This is a house that is probably very similar to, because we know that the Ballantyne-Glinky family shared a house. Then my grandfather built a house in town for the second half of the family. There were 14. The church. The priest that got this church, and we're very fortunate because he's very historically minded and he's very internet savvy. We have a lot of information on this church. And it allows people to go back and visit there, which is wonderful. You can see some of the history over here. And I've had a couple of discussions with a few people. We have no idea if there is any surname connection at all. We can just wonder. We don't have any idea. 1926, 1938. This is the Protestant altar, and that would, pardon me, be all the Ballantyne children who have been baptized there. This is what it is now as Catholic, but they have retained the Christian Christ crucifixion picture and put it in conjunction with the Catholic. There is a close relationship between Grove's version and the Falling Bostel Rummelsburg Land Organization, as you will see. 1986, the fence is very dark on here, but it's just a chain link fence. This is the intersection that is basically the main street of town. They have documented all of the repairs, and so this is, no fence has been replaced. And they have everything, and it's really kind of special. I think it's very special. The 25th anniversary would have been of being Catholic, not of being Protestant. And Emil Krupp, who was the man with the accordion in that other picture, his niece and daughters have been traveling. And this is his daughter sitting here, and they have, in 94, came and worshipped at the church of their father. The bell, 1777, and it was melted down during World War II and replaced again. This is the inscription on it, which brings it back to the Meyer family again. 2006. With the school that's on the left, the library is upstairs. We're getting to that. Ingrid and Helmer looking. This is, everybody has to have a cobblestone picture, road picture. This is mine. the main door, original door, which is original. We asked what were the original things of the church left, and the door is one of them. These signs are interesting. This whole is all on the internet. I don't think it's interesting that they posted outside the church. The priest has obviously done a lot of work. This sign means that it is historically protected now. And this is the church sign as it exists today. Now, these are the original chairs. Now, the original chairs would be, to me, the first church building, 1710. I kind of think that might be a stretch, but they're original, at least to my dad's time, I'm sure. The pulpit is original. There is much written about the donations that were given to the church, original artwork, many things to beautify it. This, I'm sure, is the original pulpit. You can see that it also has, you know, the crucifixion, the Protestant symbol. This is how it looks, the altar looks, and they use brick, which I think is, it's affordable for them, for one thing. This doesn't really do this justice. It's beautiful when the light comes in. They are adding stained glass windows. But this is when you come to the church of your parents for the first time, you have your God moment. And we have a lot of God moments as we toured the church. The stained glass windows that are going in, and they've got this all documented. The artists that have done them, it's really very special. This is how it, in 65, looking from the altar back toward the door. It now, that's a bad sign. Yeah, the Hymn of Christ from Augsburg or Lamb from Font, they donated a new organ to the church, so they have a very close relationship with them. And that plaque is on the organ, and this is what it looks like in 2006. And the plaque was right up there. And they've redone all the woodwork and, again, all of the various, the artwork is all sequential religious scenes. I suppose it's Catholic, but the focus on art is really quite wonderful. And the floor has been replaced, the pews have been replaced. This is their town figure church, or Mother Mary, bless the, it's right by the church, which I'm sure is appropriate. Not all the towns have that. Some of those you see driving into the town, some you see by the churches. Some are by the cemeteries, not too many that I saw anyway. The school, this is where the Valentine children would have gone. And then it became, in 1930, when my uncle left, the building that I identified as the library. This is from Hans Borchert's book that he said, oh yeah, I have pictures of your aunts. But that's them. Now that building is, there's a public library downstairs, which I was quite impressed by that, and an upstairs apartment. When I walked up, we came into town, it was very quiet. We did like all of you do, and then you get out of the car and you start wandering around. And the church is over here, and I came walking down here. I went up there, first person I ran into was a man, I still can't pronounce his name, but he was a very special young man and a teacher at the school. In 1965, they put a school in the town. The gathering was, his daughter spoke fluent Polish and some, and German and some English. This is his wife, she only spoke Polish. He spoke some German and Polish. So between these two and Ingrid, I actually got a drift of what was going on in the room. But Ingrid is actually still exchanging Christmas cards with the family, so we've been able to maintain contact there. And he got the key to the church, takes you into the church, you know, like everybody does. And this is the lower grade school that was put in Grove Church in 1965, and probably is credited for the survival of the town, because it, other than the Amber Shop, really doesn't have a lot of industry. Some appalled that some of these are yours. The cemetery, unfortunately, does not look like this anymore. It's been allowed to be quite grown over, but I'm sure at some point they will put a crew together and make it right again. This is Ellie Valentine. She is number 7 and died very young. But this picture was taken for me by Ingrid at an earlier trip when they had gone to Grove Church, and then she saw the cemetery before it was thrown over, so she took that picture for me. This is the memorial that the Rumford organization was allowed to put at the cemetery for those that died. I think this is the priest that's doing all of this, but I'm not quite sure. And this is my, well, he's related to the family, Hans Ulrich. He's Margaret Ott. I posted to her guest book on the Schlabe website. She recognized the Valentine name as he is married to my cousins on her husband's side. And she recognized the surname and she wrote him a letter, and here we are. Hans Meyer was also at the dedication, he and his wife. He's in his 90s now, but when he was at the Falling Bostock gathering, he was a celebrity, boy. The Amber Shop, if anybody says, why should I go to Grove's version? They are famous for their Amber Shop. And I, of course, had to figure out what the word meant, and there you see it broken down. This was the parsonage in the parish house in 2001. Look at it today. They are really working a lot. It's all the beautiful landscaping, the exhibit of antique farm implements, that type of thing. And there's a pond down the hill there a little bit where this is hanging, and it's beautiful. We were there in September, so. The Amber Shop is like their, the home, the parsonage is just up the hill over here, and this was probably the barn, according to these older pictures. This is what it did look like, and this is what it looks like now. This is the proprietors. They've been there since at least 1994, when another relative was there and took that picture. But some of the older pictures that she had inside of the store, she either took a class in marketing or sales or something, but this looks a lot better than those older pictures. I mean, they have their selection. They're in the business, seriously. This was Ingrid, got her birthday present, some of the amber that I brought home. The bucket lights were so quaint and cute, I had a picture. And they take all major credit cards now. This was the house, the single house that my grandfather built, and we have a picture of it in 1972. And this, I came by this picture quite miraculously. It's a long story, so I won't tell you, but that's a picture of one of the two pictures I have of my grandfather. They just didn't take a lot of pictures. Or they were lost in the war. I think that might have been it. Although when we found cousins, they don't have a lot of pictures either. So when they ran, they ran. And the house is in a kind of, this is the road right here. And the school sign. So this direction is that lower grade school. And so it's right across the street from that, sitting down kind of in a little valley. Not a very good picture, but it was the village street in 1921, the fire brigade, the bar, a very famous dance hall. Everybody that came from the area, apparently a lot of good times happened in this. This is how it looked in 1994. Now, Emil, his niece Marion, And I just met almost another classmate here from Faribault High, Marion Crook Ball, and I graduated in 1961 together. So this is from her scrapbook, and I want you to notice, this is what she said. Where the Crook boys drank and fought. So that's out of her scrapbook. I thought that was cute. So we're going to say goodbye to the rolling hills and farmland of Grosvenor. And this winter picture was so pretty. And again, that's the intersection down there. And we're going to go to Rummelsburg just briefly. I don't have a lot of pictures of Rummelsburg, but this is my tree canopy picture. Everybody has a tree canopy picture in Poland. This is in 1986. As a matter of fact, I don't have any pictures from the better ones. This is Marion's. So she shared that with me. In 2006, the population was 10,000. And that is good size, the next only to, I think, Gdansk or Danzig, I think. So,